Hi! Hey guys, what's up? My name is Dom. Welcome back to my channel. If you're new to my channel, I typically make bookish content, movie content, and anything else in between, because I like to do whatever I want on this channel, and today's going to be bookish content. I decided to kick off the Christmas season with a Christmas book tag. This one specifically is the Christmas song book tag. I found this over at Haley and Bookland's channel, so I will link her down below, and without further ado, let's get started. So the first question is, you're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. Name a villainous character you couldn't help but love. What I want to mention, because she was the one who actually came to mind when I read this question. She's not a book character, she's a TV show character. That is Azula from Avatar The Last Airbender. I've mentioned a few times on this channel already that she is my favorite villain of all time. She has been my favorite villain of all time since I first watched the show back when I was like 11, 12 years old. And like, Azula, like, she's an asshole. Like, she's a bitch, okay? She's a huge bitch. But she was good at being a bitch. Like, you just love, like, people just love to hate her. Everything she did was so well calculated. She was constantly a step ahead of the gang. You also always knew why she was doing things, which at the time of watching this was kind of like groundbreaking to me, especially in a kid's cartoon, because I feel like, I don't know how kids' cartoons are now, but I feel like back in the day, there's always that clear distinction between good and evil, and bad characters are just bad to be bad. But like Azula, we get to know why she is the way she is. Because for Azula, you find out that at the end of the day, she has a very abusive father and she's trying not to get her ass beat by him. Which, I mean, I can't believe I have to say this, but with the way the Avatar fandom is, I'm going to say it. That does not excuse her actions. I'm well aware of that. But like, it still explains why she was doing the things she did. Which I just feel like we don't see that in kids' cartoons. Like, we don't see why villains do what they do. You know, they're just assholes to be assholes. She's also what introduced me to the concept of sympathetic antagonists. I don't know if I would define her as such, if that makes sense. It's just, she's one of the only villains, and to this day, one of the only villains I've ever truly felt sorry for. Because in Azula's case, I mean, and again, this does not excuse what she did. She did terrible things. I just remember being so amazed at 12 years old that I could just genuinely feel sorry for a character despite all they did. She did all those bad things, but at the end of her arc, that's still a 14-year-old child having a mental breakdown. That makes me very uncomfortable. Like, I think the best way I could describe how I felt is kind of like how Katara was at the end of the show. They show Katara, like, with a disturbed look on her face, and they show her looking away. That's how I feel watching Azula having her mental breakdown, because, like, it's a child, but she still did bad things. If you can make me feel bad for a person who did shitty stuff like that, your writing skills are amazing. And she's also the only villain I'm rooting for to have a redemption arc. I want to say I'm pro redemption arc. I don't want everyone to have one. Seeing her arc in the comics, it's obviously never going to happen, but like pre-comics, I really wanted her to have one. I personally thought it was doable. She had a long road ahead of her. It might just be my fan fiction taste, but I like want her. The redemption arc in my headcanon, like, she suffers a lot, like a lot. But it just might be my fan fiction taste, because I'm a huge fan of Hurt Comfort fan fiction. I wanted her to struggle and to find the path. And if you get me to want a villain to be a better person and to go through that mental trauma to be a better person, your writing skills are just top notch. Man, like, it's weird. I did not feel sorry for her throughout the show. It wasn't really until the last two episodes where I was like, holy shit, like, this is kind of haunting. I feel bad. Like, it doesn't excuse anything she did, but like, that's still a child. But long story short, villains I love, Azula from Avatar The Last Airbender. 2. All I Want for Christmas Is You. Which book do you most hope to see under your Christmas tree? So Avatar The Last Airbender just came out with a cookbook, and I love cooking, so I really want that. I hope someone gets that one. 3. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. Name a character that overcomes major obstacles and learns to believe in themselves. So my answer for that one's gonna be Kaneki from Tokyo Ghoul by Sui Ishida. This boy went through a lot of mental anguish. I love reading about mental anguish, which is maybe why I do like Azula so much and why I want her to have that full of suffering redemption arc, just because I love reading mental anguish. Kaneki is full of that. He starts out so low, I guess is the word I'm looking for, in the beginning of the series. Like, he just doesn't know what to do. He doesn't know how to obtain his goals. And at the end of this 30-plus long manga series, he finally learns how to reach those goals. And not only that, but he's happy. And he deserves to be happy after everything he went through. He can forgive himself for past mistakes. He wants to fight to live so he can go see Toka. Kaneki and Toka is my ship. There's these lines in the manga series that run with each other, because in the beginning of the manga, he says something about how the world is a cruel place, but near the end of the manga, he says the world is just is. And that's what he said, the world just is, but he says that with a smile on his face, because he finally accepted who he is, and he finally sees the beauty of the world around him. And I think that's just beautiful, especially just because he went through so much. And just also the way this series ended too, it didn't necessarily end in world peace, but Kaneki's goals were still accomplished. Like, he can go fight the good fights when he can, but what he has done already is enough. There's no reason to keep beating himself up for it. It's a great story with great art, and I highly recommend this because I am going to do an anime reaction next year. I heard the anime is not a good adaptation, but we're going to watch it together anyway. Santa Claus is Coming to Town. Characters on the top of the naughty and nice list. So for naughty, we have Ito from Tokyo Ghoul. I can't really explain why, because it would be a spoiler, but to make a long story short, she is absolutely deranged, but I absolutely love her. But in the nice list, we have Sejanus from the Ballads of Songbirds and Snakes. This is the prequel to the Hunger Games. It is a villain origin story. This is the story of President Snow when he was, I want to say, a teenager, and he was taking part of the 10th Hunger Games. He was a mentor for the 10th Hunger Games. Sejanus is a side character in this novel, and he just deserves nothing but nice things, because despite his upbringing, despite how people treat him, he still treats everyone with kindness. And you know what? All props to him. I am still sad about where his arc goes. And I read this like whenever it came out. Number 5, Frosty the Snowman. Which book melts your heart? That's gonna be Eliza and Her Monsters by Francesca Zappia. So this is about a girl who's an introvert. She doesn't really have a lot of friends, but she is the author of the most popular webcomic, but no one knows that. The author herself is anonymous, so all these people at school that pick at her don't know she's the author of their favorite comic. Then one day, the author of the most popular fan fiction of her comic comes to her school, and they, you know, they hit it off, but he doesn't know who she is. I just really love this book. It's YA contemporary. I don't really reach for that anymore, but for some reason I read it, and I fell in love. This is a book I needed in high school. Like, I could just tell young teenager me would have related to Eliza. I still kind of relate to Eliza. Teenager me was absolutely obsessed with guys like Wallace. I think was his name Wallace. Yeah, absolutely obsessed with guys like Wallace. So it was cute. Their relationship was really cute, and I miss them. Number 6, Feliz Navidad. Choose a book that takes place in a country other than your own. I went with Io Non Ho Paura by Niccolo Amaniti. This book takes place in Italy. It's about a boy who lives in southern Italy, and he finds out his father and some of his neighbors have kidnapped a boy from northern Italy, and he goes against his father's wishes to find out the truth of the situation and why his father did what he did. I read this, I want to say, 2 years ago. It's a little hazy in my mind because I did not read it in English. I did read it in Italian. My friends in Italy were telling me that this is a book they read in middle school. I really need to reread it. My Italian comprehension has like plummeted since graduating college. I don't remember what the ending of this novel was, so I want to reread it for that, and also just to help my Italian skills because they are just not good anymore. Number 7, It's the Most Wonderful Time of the Year. Which holiday themed book do you use to spread Christmas joy? The Polar Express. I think it's by Chris Van Allsburg is the author. I love this story. This is about a boy who takes a train that takes him to the North Pole to meet Santa. It's also my favorite Christmas, one of my favorite Christmas movies that I rewatch every year. But yeah, I read this like every Christmas. I love it. Number 8, Sleigh Ride. Which fictional character would you choose to spend the holidays with? Oh my god, so many. Kaneki from Tokyo Ghoul, along with Toka and all that found family. Love them. Alice Cullen and Jasper Hale from Twilight. Love them. The entire gang in Avatar The Last Airbender, so that includes Aang, Momo, Appa, Katara, Sokka, Suki, Toph, Zuko, Yue if she wants to come down. You know what? I'm gonna include Ty Lee and Mei. And you know what? I will include Azula. I'll keep her in a separate room, but I'll include her too. And then also all the Demon Slayer characters. I had Shinobu and Giyu on my list specifically because they are my two favorite characters, and also like my ship. I'm a slut for that ship. But you know what? Every single character in Demon Slayer, because I love them all so much. You know what? And I wouldn't even have separate Christmas parties for all of them. They're all invited to the same Christmas party. We live in a universe where all of these characters are real and can come to my Christmas party. Number 9. Baby, it's cold outside. Which book that you didn't like would you sacrifice to a fire to warm yourself up in the cold? That would be The Time Traveler's Wife by Audrey Niffenegger. I hated this book with every fiber of my being. The plot of this book is basically the title. It's about a woman who's married to a guy who time travels. There's so much you could do with that. Why is he not visiting the Revolutionary War? Why is he not going to the near future when the world ends? Like, he's only traveling to times of his life specifically and of the love interest life specifically, which made the story boring. It honestly could have been 200 pages shorter, but I wasn't a fan of the two main characters either. It was bad. I threw this book across the room because that's how angry it made me with how bad it was. I need to get rid of this. This was trash. I don't like this book, and I do not recommend it to anyone. It's going in the fire. Number 10, Do You Hear What I Hear? Which book do you think everyone should read? I have two books for this. So I have The Kite Runner and then A Thousand Splendid Suns, both of which are by Khaled Hosseini. Both of these books take place in Afghanistan during the rule of the Taliban. So The Kite Runner takes place from communist Afghanistan to present day Afghanistan, or present day as of writing the book. And it's about a boy who's in a higher class who's friends with someone in a lower class. And it also explores the Afghani refugee crisis, because our main character does become a refugee and explores his time in San Francisco. And then A Thousand Splendid Suns, the whole book takes place in Afghanistan, but this book explores what it was like being a woman in Taliban Afghanistan. I think everyone should read these books, but I think especially Americans should read these books, just because, I mean, as someone who grew up in a family of veterans, I was told very, very biased stories of what was going on in Afghanistan, and obviously just the way the American media was portraying what was going on in Afghanistan. I feel like Americans have one view, and then when I was reading these books, I gained another view. Because these books, like, haunted me. My biggest mistake was reading this in a public place, because both these books made me cry, but at least I was in my dorm for this one. Someone actually came up and asked if I was okay while I was reading this. I was in tears for both of them. But they're both important stories that I think everyone should read. 11. Where Are You Christmas? A book you want but isn't out yet. The only thing I'm going to say for this one is the new Korra comic that was just announced. It comes out next year. It's the only one I could think of because I don't really keep up with new releases. 12. Last Christmas. A book you started out loving but didn't end up liking. That will be the fifth book to the Miss Peregrine series, The Conference of the Birds. So what this series is about, it's about a boy who crosses some barrier. Suddenly he's in the world of 1940. He's surrounded by children who are all called peculiars, because they have some, like, special power. So I can't say what the fifth book is about, because that would be spoiling a lot of the series. But it started out strong. I shouldn't even say it started out strong. It started out in a direction I was not a fan of, but I still liked, because I like seeing all the characters together. But as the book went on, I just hated it. I think I gave this book 2 out of 5 stars. I hated the ending. But I bought the sixth book, because I can't just stop there. It's gonna be a 6-book series. I do want to see how it ends, but I'm not looking forward to reading it, because I just hated this one that much. 13. Blue Christmas. A book that made you cry. So, a lot of books make me cry. They usually made me tear up. This one made tears stream down my face, and that is A Monster Calls by Patrick Ness. This is about a boy whose mom has terminal cancer, but then every night at 12:07, a monster comes and visits him, and the monster tells 3 stories, but the boy has to tell a 4th. Man, I mean, at least I read this one not in public. This was in the comfort of my own home, because the tears just came running down my face. It is sad. Sad as hell. And the movie adaptation was actually a pretty good adaptation. And then the last question is A Marshmallow World, which is a song I've never heard of. It's the only song that's not on my Christmas playlist, and it's just a fluffy book. I don't really go towards fluffy books, so the only one I could think of is Adulthood is a Myth by Sarah Anderson. You've probably seen this art style floating around on social media. It's just comics making fun of day-to-day tasks, everyday life, and it was a good read. It was fun. It made me realize adulthood really is kind of scary, but I'm stuck in it, so there's nothing I can do about it. And that is it for this video. I hope you guys enjoyed. It was good talking about books again. I haven't really done that in a while. But if you like this video, give it a big thumbs up, comment, subscribe. Y'all know the drill. And without further ado, I'm gonna peace out, and I'll see you guys later. Ciao a tutti.